Yapa was established in 1974. It was 1974, to be precise, 36 years ago. And it was not started as a big entity. It's a very small company with a share capital of about 200,000 rupees. It was not meant to be an export-oriented company. It was mainly to meet local requirements in ship repairs and shipping. As you know, in 1970, there was a major political changes in this country. The country became politically independent from the Westminster parliamentary system and became a republic. So one of the first moves the newly elected government after establishing the republic in May 1972, one of the first moves was liberalizing, or rather taking control of the shipping activities. For Sri Lanka being an island, shipping was crucial, both for export as well as imports. I think the main concern at that time was import, because most of the commodities to Sri Lanka were imported, and there were various monopolies, various sectors that controlled importation. So the government wanted to have their own control over it. The result was formation of the Ceylon Shipping Corporation. So we acquired, Sri Lanka started acquiring some ships. Now, once we acquired some ships, they also needed some place for them to be repaired. So that's how we came into being. So we are an offshoot of the Ceylon Shipping Corporation, which was a government entity. So we also were a government entity. But fortunately for us, we were not a corporation, but a limited liability company, of which the complete shares are owned by Shipping Corporation. So that's how we started. So we got the old facilities that were available in the Port of Colombo, the three dry docks, very old cranes and other workshop facilities that were there. So we started into this market. And started with something like 12 people. So that's our humble beginnings. From day one, of course, we moved into both shipbuilding and ship repairs. But the first developmental phase was ship repairs, because we moved into, we saw the opportunity that there is a lot of potential in attracting foreign ships for repairs in Colombo. So from 1974 August onwards, we've been moving in that direction. So our approach has been to improve our facilities and to attract foreign ship owners who are not necessarily coming to Sri Lanka for cargo, but either passing or either loitering somewhere, to attract them for major dry docking repairs to Colombo. So that was one sector that we developed from day one. Then of course, subsequently we attracted some foreign equity also to the company in 1975, and therefore it became Colombo Dockyard Private Limited, with some Hong Kong based equity, small equity, about 15%. And this company was a unique entity. It was a private limited liability company where majority of the stake was with the state through the Ceylon Shipping Corporation, and there was some foreign equity. Then of course the 1977 was another major sea change in politics of this country. The party that came into power decided to adopt open economic policies instead of closed economic policies, which was a big unprecedented challenge for most of the local business enterprises, because the organization that had been thus far kind of fostered and covered or protected by the government suddenly were thrown open into the open seas. But fortunately for us, this was another opportunity. So we looked at it as a very good opportunity. Our company was anyway a company that was geared to exploit opportunities in the export market. So we moved further ahead on our export endeavors. Result was, of course, we also had a minister who was very able and capable of leading, guiding us into that direction. That was great Mr. Ajulat Mundi. And then that is the time that shipping in this country took a big boom, with the first containerized ports coming into terminals coming into the port of Colombo. So our company also moved in the same direction. So we also went into a major expansion by adding a new dry dock, which was 125,000 deadweight dry dock, and spending about $42 million for the construction. And this money all came from the company. And of course, company had to float a separate entity, a listed company called Colombo Dry Docks Limited. There was a public share issue and IPO, and we raised some money. And then, of course, we had to go and borrow capital as well. But that was one of the major infrastructure development projects that the maritime sector in Sri Lanka ventured into in as late as, or as early as 1983. So, but this was again a problematic decision, because 83 was politically another turmoil in this country, the riots and all the problems. Fighting started in 83, and that is the time we were investing this colossal amount of money. So up to 88 we were constructing the new dry dock. It took about 4 to 5 years to complete the project, and we completed the project. Of course, there were a lot of hiccups, a lot of challenges, because the government couldn't support us the way they initially promised, because the country has already waged into got itself involved in a big war. So funds were not forthcoming, so we had to go and borrow on international and available of rates. But nevertheless, the project was complete. But financially, the company was in very difficult situation. So from 88 onwards, of course 89, the problems escalated further, because the problems expanded to southern Sri Lanka as well. Then by 93, the government already decided to disinvest the company, in the company, and to go make it a privatized entity. So then international bids were called, and a Japanese company called Omamichi Dockyard Company Limited was chosen as the 51% shareholder. So then both these companies, Colombo Dockyard Private Limited and Colombo Dry Docks Limited, were restructured and made one company, and made one entity, which was with an issued share capital of 620 million rupees. What you see today is that company, which is the merger of both these Colombo Dry Docks Limited and Colombo Dockyard Private Limited. So on the new company, 51% stake was taken over by Onomichi Dockyard Company Limited, and the balance was listed in the Colombo Stock Exchange. Even then, our focus was primarily on ship repairs. But with the new dry dock, we could accommodate larger vessels, so we expanded our ship repair facilities as much as possible, along with the support that came from Onomichi. Certain restructuring changes were done in the company. The management got a lot of, independence and correct reform. So the export growth was seen. From day one, we have also ventured into shipbuilding, but then our focus, like in ship repairs, initially was the local requirement. So we looked at the Sri Lanka Ports Authority, Sri Lanka Navy, for building our vessels. There was no export-oriented focus. So we looked at import substitution, import instead of export earnings. we were very successful in that because we've been able to meet almost all the requirements of the ports at Port of Colombo, Sri Lanka Ports Authority and the Sri Lanka Navy, and we did pretty well. And the fighting, of course, gave us an opportunity also to build vessels for the Sri Lanka Navy. So we moved into some direction in that. But by early 2000, around 2002-2003, we realized that peace is inevitable. War will either finish or even by other means, peace will come to Sri Lanka. And then we really had to look at what are the options open for us to grow our business. So then we realized that there is a potential and opportunity in the international shipbuilding. So we tried to capture into that market. And in 2005, we really launched ourselves into international shipbuilding. So today, the company is export-oriented, both in terms of ship repair and in terms of shipbuilding. So this 2%, nearly 2% export portfolio is when you put both these things together. So it's the same facility, same company, which just started in 1974, but now catering to two distinct areas in maritime engineering, that is ship repairs and shipbuilding. So that's how we were able to transform ourselves into an export-oriented company. If you take today's portfolio, maybe about 95% is export-oriented, 5% is so more focus has been put into the export-oriented business. Yes, I mean the ship repair business is predominantly well, ships itself is a major engineering construction. So it definitely requires a periodical maintenance, mandatory maintenance that it has to go. That's from an engineering point of view, technical point of view. Apart from that, ships also carry valuable cargo and people. So therefore, from a safety point of view, an insurance point of view, there's a requirement for them to go through mandatory surveys and inspections periodically, to see that the vessel is seaworthy and safe for operation, etc. Unless the ship go through these kind of repair or maintenance process, it cannot maintain its class. We call its class is a classification approval, so that a third party recognizes the seaworthiness and safety status of the vessel. So you cannot maintain it unless you go through these repair. This is a difference between most of the other. If you take a motor car, once it is manufactured, it's the owner's responsibility to make sure that it is maintained. But there is no other mandatory requirement for you to repair it. But of course, now, as you know, for diesel vehicles, there is an emission control that is coming. That's a statutory requirement. But in the case of ships, since you are basically used for international trade and you are going into somebody else's territories, motors, plus you are carrying third-party cargo, whether it is liquid or dry cargo or passengers, so there is liability, huge liability. So if the ship fails or ship sinks, there is a huge liability that the insurance will have to pay. So therefore, there had to be some mandatory control on the repair status, the vessel's performance status. Now that has to go through repair. But of course, now, as you know, for diesel vehicles, there is an emission control that is coming. That's a statutory requirement. But in the case of ships, since you are basically used for international trade and you are going into somebody else's territories in waters, plus you are carrying third-party cargo, whether it is liquid or dry cargo or passengers, so there is liability, huge liability. So if the ship fails or ship sinks, there's a huge liability that the insurance will have to pay. So therefore, there had to be some mandatory control on the repair status, the vessel's performance status. You know, that has to go through repair. Now, these kind of repairs, we call them major layup repairs or dry dock repairs. because normally the ship has to be taken out of water for repair. So our job start with identifying clients or ship owners who are potentially able to bring their vessels to our yard for repairs. Then identifying their repair needs, and then offering our prices, tendering, competing internationally, and then securing business. So one of the operation is this tendering process for ship repairs and acquiring business. So our prices will fluctuate, vary depending on the international ship repair rates. But of course, it's not only acquiring the business, then we have to have operations to meet those repair requirements. Because when the vessel comes here, we have agreed on a particular rates, the prices, and then also a duration to complete the repair. Because every day that is lost in operation is a loss for the ship owner. So there will be some penalty if you don't deliver the vessels on time. So this is a kind of a normal practice that ships operate. So ship owners' attempt is to keep the ship as much as possible on the trade. So therefore we can't take all the time we need. So it has to be done very expeditiously, and also you have to be competitive internationally. So time is very important, price is very critical to attract the business. The third aspect is the quality. Of course, the workmanship, performance, whatever you do, they have to meet international standards. You cannot say this is the way Sri Lanka repairs ships, because if they are not happy with the repair standards, they can go to any other country. If you have a motor car, you can't do that. You don't like this garage, you can go to the next garage. But still, it is the same within the country. But in our case, we are competing internationally so that our business can move from here to another country. Our prices also has to be competitive internationally, not locally. There's no meaning, because there's no other repair that we are doing. In addition to that, all ship repair activity is basically witnessed and surveyed by third-party classification societies like the Lloyd's List of Shipping, American Bureau of Shipping, Veritas, such third-party agencies. They are international agencies. They have stipulated guidelines, rules and regulations, how to repair things, what to do. And all such repairs has to comply to those requirements. Otherwise, they will not accept such repairs. So we can't do the way we think is right. We have to go by certain given norms. There is a way how to do it. We have to adopt that approach and then do it. So our standard has to be at high. Finally, the last requirement that is coming today is safety, health and environment. So most of these international owners are very concerned about the safety aspect, because if there is a fire on a ship, or if there is any other accident, either to the ship's crew or to the yacht personnel, the ship's repair schedule may get hampered. You cannot train these people, you cannot get the trained people from everywhere. These are unique expertise that we have created. So we have to pay high attention to safety. Naturally, for health, we cannot adopt unhealthy practices. Now, olden days, ship repair used to be considered a dirty, difficult and dangerous industry. We call it a 3D industry. Because often very rough people, very tough people get into this kind of industries who can handle tough jobs. But today, this whole approach is changing. It is trying to be one of the safest industries which can work. Because there's enormous focus on improving safety. Of course, it's tough, so I don't think the complexity will reduce. But nevertheless, a lot of mechanization has taken place. So you have cranes, you have forklifts, you have other machinery, hydraulics equipment, etc. that you're using. But since you're using high technology, there's also danger that you will endanger yourself. So the safety concern has to again further improve. So safety is another major concern. Last but not least, environment. Ships carry a lot of a lot of complex materials. It can carry hydrocarbons, it can carry acids, it can carry various cargo in there. So you cannot just throw all these things into the environment. Emissions is one issue, plus various other waste. It can have a lot of waste material, like asbestos or some other material that is coming out of the river. So handling all this waste in a sustainable manner is also another challenge. Because with the development of the society, these things are definitely coming into the industry. So if you put this whole thing together, price, time, quality, then yes, health, environment, safety. These five factors are crucial for managing a ship repair operation. But now, if you want to do all these things, you need to have the right infrastructure, facilities, then you need to have the right technology, plus you need to have the trained and competent skills and people who can do this. So your operational domain will include having the right kind of people, training them to the right competence levels, and then organizing them to work in an efficient and effective manner so that you achieve these five key factors. So that's the ship repair operation in a nutshell. But of course, there's one other thing. You need a lot of raw materials and spare parts. Now, Sri Lanka do not produce any of these things, whether nut and bolt or a welding electric, or even to the extent hand glove or anything is not produced. So then there is another major challenge that Sri Lanka has to face in doing this kind of a business is logistics. Where to get the spare parts, how to get it, and how to make sure that you are cost efficient while importing all these spare parts and materials, and you have timely availability of these materials. So that's another operation that is going into the business. So so in a nutshell, this is how the ship repair operation goes. Shipbuilding is not different, but slightly maybe varying from that. Now there you have a major engineering product to be done. We start with what we call a specification. Owners will provide a kind of a guideline, a specification. This is the kind of a vessel that we require. And of course, there is a tendering process and acquisition of business. So it is international business acquisition approaches, international tendering. Then you acquire the business. Then you need to have a design through the project, forward design. And then you need to order all the materials and equipment that is required to complete the project. Then you need to construct the vessel. Then of course you have to integrate the whole design and the vessel with all the equipment. And then finally, you need to test it. You need to prove that it works and it meets the international requirement. And again, all this work has to be done in compliance with many regulatory and statutory requirements. One is the classification society. So each vessel is manufactured or constructed according to classification rules, whether it is Lloyd's or ABS or DNV. So they will have the guidelines. Design has to be approved by them, material has to be approved by them, even the welders, people who are doing, have to be approved by them, the production process have to be approved by them. So it is not just that you have the design, this is the way I want to build the ship, I go and build. No, it has to meet certain international standards. So then you need to develop that. So then, finally, even there are other, like IMO rules, then safety of life at sea, then various other conventions, international, UN conventions, all that has to be complied with when you are building a ship. What is current for today, or when you are delivering, that has to be met, because otherwise the ship can't be operated. So you have to be abreast with all these latest developments in international sea transportation regulatory system. So when you build a ship, it requires a lot of international interaction, know-how. So you need to build that technical capacity, and you need to manage that. So then logistics definitely up, quality, price, all that what I said earlier is part and parcel. But in addition to that, looking this as a complete product from engineering to finally commission, we call EPC, engineering, procurement and commission, from A to Z. Finally, you are delivering a product, a ship that has proven, tested, proven, vessel. Here it is, it complies with your requirements, it complies with international requirements, it complies with standards, it's tested, proven, here are the certificates, then we have ready. Then you can get the money. So it's not an easy job, it's a very challenging job, but that's what it is. So offshore engineering and heavy engineering are two other subsectors that we develop. Basically, these sectors are going to look at two other distinct areas. Heavy engineering is basically looking at some of the major engineering projects. With our this kind of knowledge and expertise on handling large engineering projects, we certainly have an advantage in handling land-based engineering projects, whether it is petrochemical or power generation, or whether it is bridges, whether it is major infrastructure development projects, and we have the know-how, because it also basically has a similar thing, but instead of doing a product or some construction work for a ship, it will be on a land base. So heavy engineering basically caters for that. But as of last year, this has been shifted to one of our subsidiaries. We spoke about our subsidiary, Dockyard General Engineering Services, and Dockyard General Engineering Services does this function separately. It's a fully owned subsidiary. We have put that company into a separate outfit so that it can really focus on this area independently. It has the backing, fullest backing and support and technical support from Colombo Dockyard, but it's on its own. It's doing pretty well, and that's it. The offshore engineering aspect is moving a little further. Apart from ships, there are other engineering constructions in the ocean, mainly in the oil and gas exploration area. So this is still a very, I would say, early stages. So there we try to handle various other engineering requirements, like maintenance of rigs and that kind of things, platforms, etc., in the offshore sector. But it's because of space constraints and certain other business issues, this is still a very primitive area for Colombo Dockyard. So it's not a very significant area for Colombo. Well, you see, any industry you have to start from what you have. Do what you can with what you have where you are. So we can't change that. That's the ground we are. We are in Sri Lanka. It has a potential for shipwrecking and shipbuilding. There is a comparative advantage for Sri Lanka to venture into it because it's an island. It's very close to the international shipping route. So that opportunity is there. Thereafter, it is catering for. How do you start a hospital? There are patients. That's a requirement to start a hospital. Then you have to create a hospital. You have to have the buildings, infrastructure, wards, surgery, theatres, etc. to do the hospital. Then you have to find the doctors, train the people, nurses, technicians, and so on and so forth, like that. So there is a business potential for Sri Lanka to grow in this thing. Then you have to look at other this thing. How did tea industry came into Sri Lanka? No one knew how to grow tree. No one knew how to pluck tea. No one knew that no one had the technology to grind tea leaves and make tea. So how did it came in early 20th century into Sri Lanka to grow tea? So, for this thing. So any industry has to start like that. So if you wait till everything is there and then of course we are going to do it, well, might as well not do it because then it is too late, right? So in our case, we look at the business opportunity, and of course, the positive factors behind it. Okay, we are island nation, so we have a knack for learning. And shipbuilding is not something new to Sri Lanka. Only many people don't know. Even before the Dutch came into Sri Lanka, we were building ships. Even during the great King Parakram Babu, we were building ships. So how did we go and invade Burma during King Parakram Babu's time? I don't think people swam from here to Burma. So you need to have ships to go. So shipbuilding was there, tradition was there, craftsmen were there, but it has not come to today's level of people. That's the difference. So when there is a need, there is a way. So you need to develop. So we have our own training. We started with our own training center in 1974. We started developing our own people. Even today, we develop our own apprentices. So Colombo Dockyard is one of the companies that, you know, like today, if you take, we may have something close to about 400 trainees studying, undergoing training. So it's a huge cost to the company, but nevertheless, we keep on developing these future cater requirements for the company as well as for the country. So not all 400 will join Colombo Dockyard, not that we will be able to take them as well. So part of that, majority of that will definitely go to the market, to various other industries. But whatever we want, we will take from that. So that's how we, technology-wise, of course, you need to develop your engineers, you need to develop your technology. That's also another aspect. We have a partnership with Japan that helps in a way, but apart from that, even independently, we have to bring the technology that is necessary to complete it. So it's a challenging thing, but not an impossible thing. How will the garment industry come into Sri Lanka? Same way. When we were small, if you ask what is the machine, sewing machine, we will say single sewing machine. But if you ask today, we will talk about a different jute machine. So we didn't know this kind of things existed at that time. But then that technology, as well as the skill and competence, became a common factor once it is introduced. So these are things entrepreneurs have to factor into their business. Well, as a strategy, differentiation is our strategy. We have to differentiate ourselves from others, otherwise you won't get the business. So, it has to be a package. You cannot say we are best in quality and therefore too expensive, no one will be interested. If you are very cheap, very poor in quality, again no one will be interested. So there is a balance, there is a trade-off, there is some level each company would try to portray themselves to be in the market, to attract the business. It depends on the market requirements. So we have to understand what the market is asking for, what is the level of quality, what is the level of pricing, what is the level of competency, what is the level of competition that the market is asking for. And this varies for the time. But by and large, there is a regional or a zonal competition. So our competition is definitely not global. So even if there was a shipyard, again, the issue is, since the business is not local, we will be competing for the same vessel in the region, whether it is an Indian owner or a Singaporean owner, whatever it is, we will be competing for the same owner. So our competition is therefore regional. No, I wouldn't even say international, because we won't be competing with a shipyard in US, for example, or in Brazil, but in this geographical locality we will be competing. So our biggest competitors I think this is the global competitor, is China. And China, with its huge infrastructure, very developed technology and other supply base, the world is finding it very difficult to compete with China. If you listening to something called BRICS, especially Russia, India, China, and Korea, and South Africa are doing that deal. China is a dominant producer. None of those countries in the BRICS can compete with China. No can for us. Because China is the lowest price that you can do. They definitely is a major problem. So if you ask me what do we do, that's reality. So we just don't compete. Allow them to have what they want. You can't. If you can't, you can't. There's no point trying to do what you can't. So if someone is competing, Chinese yard is competing, and you say, then you go to China. You find something else. So we have to differentiate what can we produce more than China. Not in terms of price, in terms of delivery, in terms of quality, in terms of performance, in terms of transparency. So there are things that you can find. So we price in this cordless marketing thing is only one. But we can change the product. So we can differentiate our product, our perception, what we are doing. That is where the quality, safety, environment and all these things come. In China, you may get a very good price, but you may not get all the other things. So therefore, the owner may be coming back to us. So that is something. Then of course, the other competitor for us regionally is the Middle East, mainly Dubai, Bahrain, the Gulf shipyards. They compete with us because they have exceptionally large and highly developed, sophisticated infrastructure facilities, which has been developed by the government and given more or less free to the companies for operating. So whereas we have to fight with our own developmental costs, etc., these are, there aren't big overheads. And most of the Gulf yards operates in a completely different model. Most of their employees, almost 100%, are expats. So they are on a hire and fire. So they pick up and choose. They don't develop their own cadre. So if we develop welders, they will try and take our welders there at a higher price. But the difference is, when you are in that kind of a working environment, naturally, labor rights, trade unions, all these things are negated. So they work in a completely different environment. So you may get a salary, but you sacrifice certain other rights or other these things. But we operate according to Sri Lankan rules. We have trade unions function. We have our employee negotiations. We have our own holidays. We have the poor days. We have the election days. We have the Singhal. We have the Vesak. We have the Poson. We have the funeral houses. We have the weddings. All that we have to live. So now that's the difference. So Middle East is another competitor in that terms, because that's a completely different model, working model. So we are basically from the East, we are competed by China. And then now, of course, there are some new competition coming from certain other yards in Indonesia, like Batam, Indonesia. They are building yards as well as repairs, but predominant shipbuilding yards. They are competing with us. So that's another aspect. Regionally, on the shipbuilding area, certain new Indian private sector shipyards are also posing a threat in terms of competition. So our strategy is to find our own what we call the blue ocean in our strategy of differentiation. How can we differentiate from all of our competitors? What is good in us but not available in others? And find and develop it. So that's what we do. We are very well reputed for, we are not one of the cheapest yards. Price-wise, we may not be the most competitive, most cheapest yard today. So price-wise, we may not get the best rank. But when it comes to delivery time, we are very good. If you promise a date, you deliver on that. And our quality standard is at high level. So we try and maintain. Our environmental concern is at a high level. our safety record is at a high level. But that alone will not definitely sell ourselves. We are also very flexible. We are very customer-centric here. We try and adopt a lot of Japanese approaches in this. So we try to create an overall brand that is different to other yards. So now China, you're not sure about the quality of the vessel that you're building. You're not sure about the legal instruments and, you know, all the utilities, because the language spoken is Chinese, and you really are not sure what is going to happen tomorrow with some of these things, because it's a big bureaucracy. And it's, Sri Lanka has a very straightforward this thing. Most of our people speak English. We adopt English law. There's transparency, and transaction is very straightforward, clear. Then India, you have again a lot of delays and other issues. Bureaucracy is playing at this thing, so we can differentiate from that. So likewise, we need to find our own model. So that's basically what we do. It depends on what we do. In the ship repair, of course, we are basically the regional leader, if you take South Asia. So our main market is India. About 60 to 70% of our business currently is from India on the ship repair. There is no Indian ship repair yard that can really challenge us at this position today. But we don't get, now we are trying to try and focus towards Far East, because we want to move, don't want to be on one particular market, because Indian market is also changing. So we are now trying our best to put more effort into the Far Eastern market, Singapore, Japan, Korea, that area, and try and attract more vessels from that side as well, so that there is a balance in our business effort. When it comes to shipbuilding, of course, we penetrated to Middle East, India, Singapore, basically these three areas. But we now contemplate to first consolidate in some of these areas, plus further expand our marketing potential, our penetration approach. So this is a gradual process. Depends, but we are not building each and every vessel that is available. We are only specializing on certain niches. In a niche market, we specialize on offshore oil and gas exploratory vessels, support vessels for that industry, as well as passengers and some other harbor craft and certain coast guard vessels. So there are certain categories of vessels that we specialize on. So we work on those things. When it comes to very large ships, we are not in that, because our infrastructure, our capacity is not to meet those records. So first you have to identify what product you are going to sell, what niche market, and then identify the regional territories where you are going to sell. So in terms of territories, we are definitely in our niche, we are trying to move as far as possible, because shipbuilding allows us to, it's possible to build ships to anywhere. But ship repair, of course, the localities, the geographical closeness is very important, because otherwise ship has to come idly to Colombo, and after that it has to go idly. Yeah, I think first advantage that you get is there will be a lot of independence and innovativeness that can be built into the organization. There is a major involvement of foreign partners. Because, you know, when you do a business in a particular geographical location for longer period. What is happening is you develop your own kind of box, or own contours, own boundaries, and say, okay, this is what we can do in Sri Lanka. There's nothing better. You may become Sri Lanka's best, but does it mean anything? Internationally, nothing, because Sri Lanka's best may not necessarily be world's best. So when you go, when you're in international business, what is relevant, what is important is not doing best practices in Sri Lanka, but doing better practices that you can adopt from abroad, because you are competing with others. So therefore, you need to benchmark, you need to move out, you have to get out of this box. And this was the case in Colombo Dockyard as well, because as long as the company grows and it has business potential, you know, we are doing well. So in Singala, you call that Lindeinna Madia's frog in the well's mentality. The frog thinks that this is my world, you know, I'm doing pretty well here. But he doesn't realize that just beyond the well also there's a world. So you need to look at it. So I think this is the first advantage. You will be able to think beyond your own boundaries. So that's number one. More than technology. If the management and the leadership of the organization can adopt that thing, which is very difficult, because they're already deep-rooted into the organization you are in, and you don't want to change. And these are psychological challenges. These are transformational challenges that an organization has to go through. And Colombo Dockyard has definitely gone through these challenges in my experience. So some generations will have to change, people change, a lot of things happens, some strains do occur in the organization. So foreign direct investment is not without any blood being spread. There will be some strains, some resentment, some discord within the organization. But on the other hand, it allows you to look at some. So maybe initially there will be some recovery. That is, but the advantage is you benchmark yourself, you move out of where you are and you think different than. That's one. Second, of course, is technology. When developed country like Japan or a European country or even another developed country is your partner, you always are exposed to something advanced. So therefore you can go and look at it. Yeah, you can share some of those learning. You can train the people. You know, those advantages definitely will come. And there is a second way of doing things, you know, that can come. So that's another advantage. The third advantage is marketing wise. So you kind of try to, you are no longer a local company, but you are looked at, okay, you have a Japanese partner, so there's a Japanese involvement. So you have certain Japanese ethos, approaches to business. So you can piggyback on that for a short while. Of course, that's not long lived unless you can meet those requirements or what is expected by the market. So, but initially you will have that advantage. So those are things that will come. And apart from that, you know, you get out of the local traditional politics and other things and try to focus more on what is internationally practiced. Otherwise, this is the way all local companies work. We close 7 days for similar activities. Or no one returns to work after the election day. I think yesterday was the working day after the Singala Day. Now our attendance yesterday was exceptionally good. Now how does this happen to us? In other companies it doesn't happen. They will say, okay, 18th you will have only 50% or 40%, then 19th. I know a relative of mine who was working in Colombo went home, way down to Badulla. He said, I put 4 days leave. So then I have 18th, 19th, 20th, 21st, 22nd is Good Friday, 23rd, 24th. So his new year starts from 14th to 24th. You see? because he is in a local context. But in our case, okay, we know, we have a lot of commitment, we've been talking to the people, we worked up to this, and even during the New Year's Day, there were certain people who were working here. So that advantage. So I think having a foreign partner is, it's a positive thing, particularly in a complex industry like this. Owners have to invest money to build ships. No shipyard is building vessels on their money. Shipyard builds vessels on owner's money. So if the owner is not willing to spend, willing to invest, then there's no business. Now, why does the owner spend money, invest money? Because of possible future exploitation of the vessel and taking a better rate. So if a ship costs $25 or $30 million, so you invest $30 million thinking that, okay, in X, Y, Z period, we can recover this money and earn much better. Otherwise, he doesn't have investments coming. He can put that in the bank and get a decent return. So he must be able to get a better return. So it's a, I would say, high risk, high return investment is shipping. So if the market trends are good for this kind of development, these owners will invest money. If the market trends are bad, then of course these owners will not invest money in this kind of business. There has to be demand, there has to be requirement. But fortunately, when there is a general economic growth, naturally all these requirements are growing up. You know, if the economy is growing, the motor car industry will grow. If the motor car industry is growing, more fuel is required for, petroleum products are required for running the industry. If more petroleum products are required, more exploration will take place. More exploration to take place, more offshore drilling will have to take place. More offshore drilling to take place, more ships will have to be built. So that's how the chain works. There's no way. It's only supply and demand, famous theory, that is all what is working. But then it's so complex. You see, so owners will not just throw money unless that confidence is there. So the global economic recession in 2008, October, was a major blow to the entire shipping industry. Because the whole confidence level in the market dropped. Because world just stopped growing. You're growing, suddenly no growth. So then what happens? Then everybody is panicking. And then on top of that, we had the economic crisis plus the currency crunch. Now that really was a major thing. But we are very slowly, gradually recovering from that difficult period. So the future looks, I would say, optimistic. But at the moment, it's not very good. And if you ask me about 2005, I would say yes, it's booming for the next 5 years, so it will be very high. Yes, it was up to 2008. In 2009, we had a lot of orders that we have secured in 2008. In 2010 onwards, it has been a tough time. But I think now the economic resilience is coming slowly and definitely. So hopefully by about end of 2001, early 2010, we should get back to normal operation. So a lot of factors, the global economy will impact the shipbuilding business. Credit availability, the desire of owners to invest money, because they don't invest their own money. They may be investing only 70%. The balance has to be borrowed from the financial system. Now, financial system will borrow only if funds are available, and then they can, they have reliability of getting returns. So this whole thing changed in 2008. Now again it is coming back. There is a market correction that is taking place. that's how it works. Well, the success factors. I think number one is from the day one, I think, before even we came into the collaboration with Japanese, we were a unique entity. If you ask any Dockyard employee, they'll say, we are different. We don't work or think in the same way as many others. For us, Dockyard is an identity. See, you ask anyone, any employee, not only me, go down even to a subcontractor and ask, where are you working? They say, I'm working at Dockyard with so much of pride and importance. And what is Dockyard? Hey, Lanka, you never then? That's the kind of pride. So it's a unique entity. We have created that pride. We have created that uniqueness. So it's that aspect, being able to create that, I would say, connection with the company and bondage with the company and the job. That's a fun success. So everyone is so committed. I'm not saying there are laissez-faire guys, some stupid fellow doesn't work. They will be because they are part of the society. But by and large, the majority believes in the company. Majority is with the company, and they are so much attached to the company. So much so that our trade unions and everyone only talks about the prosperity of the company. So it is not individual centric, or it is not one man centric, or anything like that. It is more organization centric approach. That has really helped us to be different. So therefore, it's easier for us to get into this, resort, and work as a get everyone. I told you about the breakfast. A breakfast for at least 1,800 people, that's a permanent and all the trainees, are provided by the welfare association. The company only pays 42 rupees per day per person. And the welfare association, which is basically volunteers who have been elected once a year, have to make sure that they organize the entire breakfast. Now let's say we do the same exercise in Kerala University. Now you have your students council, and then government's VC says, okay, from tomorrow onwards I am going to give you 30 rupees a person to get yourself organized for the breakfast. While doing your studies, if you don't work, you will get punished. Will you be? Yeah, also. Just because you are welfare, you don't get your salary. That's not your job. They will have to organize themselves, motivate, but then make sure that you organize this. Can you get people to do this kind of thing? Excellent. And you get scolded by the others. But they have to do it. And they are committed to do it. Okay? And manage. Provide accounts at the end of the AGM. If there's a shortfall, answer for that. And get ridiculed from the members. Get ridiculed from the management. Management might even take disciplinary action against it. That there is a fraud. Right? But they have to do it. And they are doing it. So that's the kind of involvement. So uniqueness of the people, and it's their involvement. operation. It has its pros and cons, but that is one success factor. If we can fine-tune it towards to create a good of the company, that is. Then of course, I think we are also geographically we are in a very convenient location. That is another success factor. So people involvement plus this definitely are two. And third, of course, foreign collaboration has given us a lot of independence, freedom, and kind of ability to think independently. And then we are a very innovative company. We don't set goals that are very easy to find. We set goals that are very difficult to achieve. We take very big leaps in our improvements, not step by step. Very big leaps. So those are some of our one of the crucial change, transformation that we did, I mean, different way. If you take infrastructure, I think we, with a modification, broke a gate in block number 2, which was connected, which was built in 1937. In 2005 or 2006. And that was a crucial decision. That basically changed our horizons of shipping. And we had to break that. That was a bottleneck, real bottleneck. If anyone asks me to talk about a bottleneck, that was a bottleneck. So that bottleneck has to be taken out. We took a unique decision to break it. Let's face it. Technologically challenging, but we did. That is one. Then transforming these people who were, with the privatization, of course, the people were, people also, and 1977 political change made the people more, how to say, money-minded. So, kind of that kind of personalities. Now, how can they, that kind of a person, be converted into a loyal employee who is working for a greater cause, for the greater growth of the organization, changing that mindset. Right. So you really have to transform these people's thinking. It's not easy. So that was a. So we had to adopt a lot of strategies and a lot of decisions on changing attitudes, building values. Inculcating values, changing attitudes, and thereby changing the behavior of the people. In 2001, our people were walking on the streets with placards, not building ships. Right? In 2008, we were delivering ships to India. So that's a transformation. That's also another major decision. Then of course, technologically challenging, very difficult technological achievements. Building one of those complex vessels is a very, very tough job. It's not easy. But having confidence on the people and your own teams and empowering them to do it. Those are difficult challenges. You really have to put your neck under the guillotine. Because if it's successful, fine, you have won. Fail. Who will lose? Who will be chucked away? Number one is the CEO. Those are management challenges.